surprises.
As I sit here looking and thinking and talking to you,
yeah,
as Barbara Bain, a very, very sophisticated lady. I mean, a lady who's tasted life. Do you have a man in your life?
No, not at the moment.
Why?
I
know you're busy with your children.
Oh, no, I'm not busy with my...
Yes, you are.
You mean the little
ones
reading?
Yeah, the little ones reading. But
what a question. Why?
Yeah, why?
I'm not opposed to the idea. Let's put it that way.
Is it difficult out there to find someone? Are you looking?
Sure.
You are looking?
Sure.
Because some people back out. They don't want...
No, I'm backed out of anything. Yeah. I used to say, fella had to be intelligent, good looking, and have a great sense of humor. And now I'm thinking, maybe we'll just leave great sense of humor and get the other ones off the list.
That is my most important sense of humor.
I think that must be it.
Is it?
Because, sure. Yeah, and one needs it more as one goes.
Looking at Hollywood starring Skippy Lowe. How do I look? Do I look trashy? Because we've got a girl who starred in the movie Trash, one of the last surviving Andy Warhol superstars. She's so big that she's written a great book, and it's called A Low Life in High Heels. And anyone who wants to tell you that they're a personal low life in high heels deserves my black glove. So let's eavesdrop carefully on Hollywood Lawn with Skippy.
15 years old. I can't believe it. 15 years old as a young boy living in Miami Beach. Miami Beach, tough town. I mean, that is tough.
Horrible. My moon was not over Miami. Well, this was in what? Early 60s.
Early 60s.
Yeah.
Went to New York, hitchhiked, bus.
Uh-huh.
Hitchhiked?
Well, okay. It started...
As a young boy, though. 15.
15 and a half.
Going to New York City. Come on, Hollywoodland. Tell me.
Star. Well, actually, I took a Greyhound bus to Brunswick, Georgia, and it was tossed. Well, only $11.
Right.
I had and it was tossed off the bus in the middle of this thunderstorm, and I was hit by lightning. Actually, a Coke machine next to me was hit by lightning. But like I said, Florida was hideous. I went right away. I wanted to go to New York because Cleopatra with Elizabeth Taylor was opening at the Rivoli Theater.
Right.
Ever since, actually, it all started when I was 10 years old. I saw Lana Turner and The Prodigal.
Right.
And I said, this is it. This is
you
it.
Want to be glamorous.
I'm a temple person. I'm mm-hmm. a, you know, I have to, you know, mm-hmm. go somewhere. I don't know. I don't know.
And
why
your name was then what? Arnold?
What was Harold.
Harold.
Your name was Harold.
Little Harito.
Harold?
Yeah, you're Puerto Rican.
Now you know why I changed it to Holly.
Puerto Rican. Mm-hmm. You're from Puerto Rico.
I'm confused.
Puerto Rico. Little Puerto Ricano.
Yeah, so go ahead. Didn't you, what happened then, Harold?
So anyway, I saw these movies and it never dawned on me to like hitchhike to Hollywood.
Right.
New York, because of Cleopatra and Elizabeth Taylor.
Right.
And so I only had $11, and that's as far as the Greyhound bus would take me. And so from then on, I was with a friend. It was mad queen with the eyebrows that went up here named Russell and long nails. And Russell Seaboard, I was always in awe of him and wanted to be like him. So anyway, after this
he was an older person, naturally. You were 15, he was older.
I was 15 and a half, he was 15 and three quarters.
Oh, okay. So you're at the same age.
No, I think he was about 16, 17.
Okay.
And that night, we were in the middle of the thunderstorm and we were gonna start hitchhiking. And the lightning hit this Coke machine and I was thrown like 30 feet and this big fat woman from this motel that, you know, came and gave us a room for the night because she was scared that, you know, I don't know why. That
two boys, young boys, 15 years old.
Yeah, that they take
had
her
no
license
place to
away.
Sleep,
she was probably selling drugs in the back.
Right.
Anyway, so that night, I shaved my legs and plucked my eyebrows. And I don't
know that's when it all began?
And that's how
it
became from Harold to Holly.
Yes, oh. And then Lou is Reed that, wrote a song about that, it.
Is that when it all began, that
that's
night?
That's when it all began.
Yeah, you didn't do it in Miami at all at that time? You didn't
No,
do it?
I was too scared. I mean, you know, if you knew Miami then, you just...
So you didn't do it. So you just shaved your legs and did the eyebrows and left that camp and went to New York.
And stuck my thumb out.
Tell me when you arrived in Manhattan, when you got off that bus.
A full blast woman.
Yeah, really?
No. For the 60s, you know, I may as well have been.
Did you get off at Port Authority? Did you get off the bus there?
Actually, no. A trucker gave us our last ride. Oh, at one point we were picked up by four Marines, and Russell had a fabulous time in a little motel with them. And stupid that I was at that time, I was like, you know, very quiet. I'm like,
at 15 years old.
Yeah, I thought they were going to throw us off the side and, we'd be found in pieces. But Russell had a divine time with the boys.
Okay.
Anyway, so somehow or another, we ended up in New York City about a week later.
Right.
In one piece. Right. In Times Square, and I remember, you know the park on Bryant Park. It's behind the library on Fifth Avenue.
Of course, of course.
That little teeny park.
That little park.
Well, when I arrived,
everybody goes to that little park on It's on 42nd Street.
Exactly.
It's on 42nd between 6th and American
and
Avenue and Osiris.
Behind, right behind the that's big right. library. Well, that's I thought that was Central Park.
Right.
So I lived there for about.
You stayed.
I thought that was. That's how much I knew.
Know.
I love it.
Well, I learned real quick.
Yeah.
I learned real quick, but.
So what happened then?
Well, I mean, New York City at that time. Well, I did what everybody does, you know.
I know.
These poor little kids, you know, you have to, you know, the things they have to do.
Did you get involved in drugs at that age?
I got involved in everything.
Really?
I had to sell my little chochita at 15.
You sold everything. You really
everything.
Did it all.
I sold
and a
everything.
Dog.
My jewelry, my diamonds, my furs. Darling, I
how
sold
did
it
you,
all.
When how I did you meet Andy Warhol at that time?
Andy,
come on, let's get back.
Yeah, well, God, I mean, that's why. That's what my book is about. I mean, I was lucky enough to be living in New York during the height of those eras, the 60s, with the Stonewall riots. I was in the middle of that.
You certainly were.
And Woodstock, and of course, during the underground, the Andy Warhol era with all the superstars. Right. And
Midnight Cowboy. Do you remember the movie Midnight Cowboy?
They
went cruising down 42nd Street looking for...
One of those little hallways.
Yeah, were looking for one of those people to come up to the party. Remember that party scene?
Yeah, I sure do.
That's the kind of life you lived.
That was it.
Am I right?
Very much, yeah.
Hanging around 42nd Street.
First came here.
Tough, that street.
But then, then I met Candy Darling, Jackie Curtis, and then they introduced me to Andy Warhol, and we used to...
Jackie Curtis did, and Danny,
and Candy. And right. We used to hang out in a place called Max's Kansas City, which was the home...
In the village, towards the village.
Yeah.
Right.
That's where all the beautiful people, all the...
Why do they say beautiful people?
Because everybody was always on the cover of Vogue. Everyone was a movie star. Everyone was a model. Everyone was famous. Everyone was rich. Everyone was beautiful. Everyone was dripping in diamonds. Uh-huh. That's when you could walk the streets and, and jewelry.
What was your first meeting with Andy? Your very first meeting. Who introduced you, and how did it all happen?
He said, tell that me. Face. I said, that wig. Where'd you get it from?
Is that what he said?
You got in Tibet?
Did you really say that?
Well, you know, Andy's white hair was like... Actually, I met Andy at a screening of Flesh that Candy and Jackie were in with Joe DeLisandro.
Right.
And it was funny because I was really nervous. Some friends of mine took me because they said, "Oh, wait till Andy meets you. You'll be his next superstar."
Right.
And of course, I wanted to be one. And so I remember, in the sea of all these heads and stuff, and all these Chardonnay drinking people, and I remember Nico, this tall, Swedish, woman standing there. So I was just in awe of all these wonderful, fabulous, strange people.
Right.
And there at the end, on top of all this, was this little tuft of white thing.
Uh-huh.
Just sort of and it was Warhol, it was Andy.
He speaks soft, doesn't he?
The first thing he said to me was, what's your name?
That's soft. Softly.
Oh.
Real softly.
You look so glamorous. Uh-huh.
And what did you say?
Ooh. Nobody asked her. He said, what's your name? I said, Holly. He said, oh, well, do you have a last name? I went, no, but the next time you meet me, I will.
How did you get Hollywood?
Holly came from...
First,
Miami, FLA. No, Holly was from the Truman... Holly Golightly.
Truman Capote's Breakfast in Tiffany.
Oh, sure.
Breakfast at Tiffany, of course.
Because for a while there, we all thought we'd be discovered in front of Tiffany.
So that's where Holly
in the morning,
came from.
You know?
Okay.
And of course, I used to whistle for... for cabs.
Right.
And then the Woodlawn came from an episode of I Love Lucy.
Right.
The episode where she's got the urn on her head, the loving cup. It's stuck on her head.
No, I don't remember. Go ahead. I don't know.
Anyway, well, at one point she's sitting on the subway, and behind her it says Woodlawn.
Oh, okay.
And the last stop on the train is the Woodlawn Cemetery.
Oh, right.
In the Bronx.
Right.
So this was right after I had met Andy, and we were trying to figure out a last name for me, and with all sorts of things that were like Holly Garbo, you know, Holly. Everything, but we saw this and we thought, how fabulous. Holly Woodlawn.
That's great.
And plus, another thing was that most of the Andy Warhol female movie stars were heiresses.
Right.
Ultraviolet, International Velvet. You know.
What kind of woman was Ultraviolet?
Very French, very, very.
This is the one that was in trouble, wasn't she? Wasn't the one?
Could you tell me who Ultraviolet is? Because I don't think maybe everyone knows that. I don't know.
Oh, Ultraviolet is one of Andy's, one of his female superstars.
People, very, very big female superstar. Mm.
So anyway, they were all heiresses. So anyway, so back to the Woodlawn Cemetery. So I thought, oh, fabulous, Holly Woodlawn. This way, I'll be an heiress too.
Right.
At heiress to the Woodlawn Cemetery fortune.
Uh-huh.
All that marble and granite and real estate and who can contest it?
That's right.
Who's going to contest that?
That's very funny.
So that's how Holly Woodlawn was born.
Yeah. So Andy Warhol put you in the film Trash, first film.
Yeah, actually
with Joe D'Alessandro.
With Joe D'Alessandro, but it was Paul Morrissey who at that point because after Warhol was shot. The entire factory.
You were around that at the time when he got shot?
I came right after.
After.
Right after. Because before then, the factory itself was more like a party scene. It was lots of drugs and lots of parties and stuff.
Did Andy take a lot of drugs?
I don't think he took
anything. He took anything.
Anything.
Am I right?
I don't know.
Did he drink at all?
White wine or whatever.
Oh, but that's it?
Oh, no, not, you know, it was, you know, and the funny thing about it was the people around the satellites.
Surrounded him.
They were the ones that were fabulous.
Him. They protected him, didn't
Plus,
they?
Plus, they were the ones, because Andy himself was very quiet, very nothing.
That's absolutely nothing. You know, that's true, Andy.
The people around
absolutely.
Him that were fabulous.
They were the ones. They were
made
the
it
ones
happen.
He surrounded.
He was like an observer. Huh?
Yeah, Electric. They were the Andy Warhols. Am I correct?
Exactly. And and the fact that he attracted all these incredible people.
Right.
I mean, besides the fact that he also was a genius at commercial
art. Why do you think he got
shot
stuff? That time when that girl got upset? Why did she get upset?
Oh, well, first of all, I mean, if you would...
she was really angry at him.
She was... Yeah, she was a very sick, crazed woman.
She
a
was.
A real mental case, yeah. But the thing is, this is another thing that before, you know, Andy, the people that he was hanging out with, that he let allow into his life, into that, were a lot of drugged out, crazy, I mean, really, people that belonged in
mental
institutions, away.
Yes. Yeah. Why did he let those kind of people into his life, and he did not let Madison Avenue people? He was afraid of those people.
Because
he was afraid of those people.
Because they were exciting, and Madison was boring. I mean,
is it
still
really?
Is.
Do you think so? Is it boring? He liked that excitement because
it was
he wasn't.
All that. Yeah. I mean,
because Andy wasn't exciting.
No,
he was not exciting.
He was nothing. I mean, he was a little peasant boy from Pittsburgh.
That's right. Took a bus,
to
went
come
to New
York.
York
like
that's
I
right.
Did.
Absolutely.
Wow.
Took the same bus,
I
went
hit
to
my
New York.
Lightning. He didn't.
Same
he
as Madonna.
Did.
Madonna did the same thing.
Uh-huh,
got
yeah.
off the bus with a bag and got into New York and start making her thing. And that's what happened to Madonna.
Sure.
So Woodlawn.
I remember
Andy
Madonna.
Andy Warhol. This is what happened. They don't come to Hollywood to do that. It's hard. It's hard to come to Hollywood to do that. You go to New York to do that to be successful.
Because I think so. Well, first of all, in Hollywood you get so lost. I mean, because you have to be beautiful and strong or whatever,
right.
You know. And now that I'm living here, it's like not. But New York.
Are you living here now?
Yeah, I've been here for 3 years now.
Three.
Oh.
Do you like it?
Love it.
What makes you love it in leaving New York? Because New York is a great city.
Yeah. Okay.
It's the greatest city in the world.
I know. I was just there. What, a couple of weeks ago, and I just couldn't wait to get back. But you know what? As far as I'm concerned, now I did everything
you
there was to do in New York.
Yeah.
There is to me, after a week, you've done it.
Yeah.
You know, as far as New York is concerned.
I see.
Yeah,
go ahead.
And everybody's here. Everybody from New York.
From New York is here now.
Now that the airline, you know, now it's like,
right,
you know.
Right. Joe D'Alessandra, let's talk about Joe D'Alessandra.
Yeah.
Trash.
Yeah.
What kind of guy?
He's
a good guy, yeah. How did Andy and him get close together? Because Joe's living here now.
Right, yeah.
He's married.
He's acting, has
Could you tell us a little bit for some of us who don't know who Joe D'Alessandro is?
Oh,
exactly.
Annie, of course everybody knows Joe D'Alessandro. Let's not get into that. Of course it is. Joe D'Alessandro. We'll read the book, Annie. We'll show you.
Joe D'Alessandro. Show them the book.
Okay, we'll show the book later. Everybody knows Joe D'Alessandro. He worked as a cab driver for a while.
Uh-huh.
He's had some tough times. Tell me about Joe D'Alessandro. How did he meet Andy? Do you know?
No, I don't. I mean, that was before, because when I came there, he had already done Flesh.
He did Flesh. He did a movie in Cherry Grove. He did the film in Cherry Grove. Did you go to Cherry Grove, at Andy's place in Cherry Grove? Up in the...
In Montauk, in Long Island.
Yeah, you did go up there.
Mm-hmm. Once.
Any parties up there, crazy parties?
Well,
a lot of crazy parties up there.
Sure, I mean, you go to Andy's and what?
I meant orgies parties. I'm talking about.
Oh no,
orgies.
No,
no,
no. It was very civilized. But
it was.
Yeah,
I see. He was civilized then.
Very, very. But he was also into this whole
into
commercialism.
What?
The whole going out with society, you know, all that.
Is that what made you? Andy Warhol with the Campbell soup? It's to me. I still can't believe
it. Baffles
me.
It baffles
you
my
too?
Mind. But it's very easy to baffle my mind.
Not that it's
I don't get it. I really never did. But then you know what? That's
who
art.
Who am I?
What's
exactly.
Art, you know?
Exactly. Is that what they claim is art?
You know,
is art?
Yeah. I mean, Lana Turner's toilet paper. You know, this will probably sell for. You know, baseball cards. What makes these things? You know, these worthless things worth so much?
Hollywood Lawn, tell me, you wrote this book. This book called A Low Life in High Heels. Now, a low life, come on. Is that like living through a sewer and a glass-bottom boat?
Oh, darling, this was, yes. I mean,
is it?
It was pretty low. I mean, it was pretty high, too. Low and very high. But
what is the low point of your life? I know you left at 15.
The lowest point
you were selling your body at 15 in New York City, and you had no place to sleep on the streets and this park. I mean, it must have been tough at age 15. Where was your family at that time? Back in Florida?
Well, I had run away from home.
You ran away.
I didn't keep in touch with them. They had no idea.
Going back, you sorry you ran away from home? Would you?
No, I'm
come on, think
no,
about it. Think
no,
you're not?
I do it.
So you do it the same way?
Yeah.
You're happy?
I was lucky. I really didn't, you know, I'm very close to my parents right now.
Right.
Very close.
That's great.
So I wasn't an abused child. I just, you know, I was just...
You wanted to see life.
Yeah, I was...
You wanted
I
to
just,
get those heels on, get
exactly,
those legs out there, just, and just have a ball.
I just knew there was something better out there. I'm still searching.
Did you find something better out there, Hollywoodlawn?
Many times I have, you know. Oh, certainly better than Miami, except, well, now Miami Beach is really nice. You know?
Nice.
Uh-huh. Yes.
That little area
This picture of this book.
Beautiful.
It's Dietrich.
Picture.
Very, very Dietrich. Have you seen this?
The
Look
last time I was in San Francisco
very
doing a book signing, and this man looked at it and he said, oh, that's Marlene Dietrich.
It does.
And he thought I had written a book about her.
Uh-huh. Yeah,
because of that picture. I said, no, that's me. I mean,
it's you.
I wrote the book. He said, oh, yes, I'm Dietrich.
Uh-huh.
And I said, no, that's me. He said, oh, you look like her.
Tell me about your miserable life. So you had some miserable times in your life.
Well, you see, a good thing about I don't. I never did. I mean, because I the wonderful thing about living things and then having to write about them is because you always remember... I'm completely optimistic about everything. It's a hysterical book, by the way.
What do you mean by hysterical?
Hysterically funny.
It's
very funny.
It's a funny book.
Even my low, you know, I mean, there was a point, as a matter of fact, it's in the book, that this guy was coming out of Max's Kansas City, who later turned out to be a friend of mine, and I was like bombed. I was like crawling up, what is it, from the the gutter, I think,
right,
to the sidewalk, a little thing. I was like, you know, trying to get up on the thing. Uh-huh. And he looked down, he said, well, what are you trying to do? I said, I'm trying to get over this wall. Uh-huh. And to me, I think that says it all. But,
yeah. Is this you as a little boy?
That's me. Yeah,
I want to show
5
this.
5 years old.
Is it really? Look at that. Can I get the camera on this? Can I get the camera on this?
That was when
look
you were Harold?
That.
Little Harito.
This is it.
Harito.
Is it on me or not? I don't see it on me, but that's okay. There we go.
Yeah.
See it? That's you.
Oh,
and who's
wow.
this over here?
Oh, that's my grandmother. That's me. And that's my uncle, Virgilio. He's another
and
one.
Who's that, who's that's responsible. Below? Who's those two people? What's those three people there? Now, show me. What's those people there?
That's my aunt, my grandmother, and me.
Oh, that's you as a little boy.
Uh-huh.
Where was this? In Miami?
No,
Puerto Rico. In San Juan?
Ponce.
Ponce. And this is you as?
That's me.
That's
as
you.
As a 35-year-old person.
35 years old?
Trying to
oh, get
this. Trying to be butch.
Is you're trying to be butch. Is is Hollywood Lawn butch? Do you feel butch?
I'd pick myself up
do you
if
feel
I saw,
butch?
It, saw that.
Hollywood
yeah,
Lawn.
Very
you
attractive.
Feel butch? Do you feel butch?
You should have seen me Sunday trying to, they gave me a driver's license in this town, so I got a car. And
and you had
and
to?
My brake has been screeching, so my next door neighbor, who also wrote the book with
right.
me, Jeffrey Copeland. So we took the tire off the car, and
right.
I washed the car, and yeah, and I changed the brakes. I put brake pads on
great.
My brake.
Yourself?
Talk about butch, baby.
That's
wow.
good.
I left
the well, he did all the work, but I just acted like
how about Divine? Divine and you
oh.
were very close.
Oh,
tell
yeah.
me about Divine.
Divine was Divine.
Was he really?
Yeah, I like Divine a lot. We
what makes
we did
makes
several
you
plays
like
together.
Divine? What? Because I can never get into his movies. I'm sorry.
Oh,
I can get into your movies, but
no.
I can't get into his films. I saw.
It's not good.
Go ahead.
Well, the thing about Divine is that, see, I lived with Divine and I worked with Divine.
You
and
lived with
underneath
him?
All that Divine.
Yes.
Was a really sad and you know very lonely person.
He was.
Yeah. Because Divine wanted to be skinny. I mean, Divine.
He wanted to be skinny. I see.
Yeah.
I
and,
see. And Andy, tell me about Andy. What's this? What's this? You're opening at the Rose Tattoo. Come on.
This the 23rd.
You're opening at the Rose Tattoo, the 23rd.
Uh-huh.
And where is that? In West Hollywood.
Uh huh. It's and now changed. It's now called the Rose Garden Performing Center.
Rose Garden Performing. Did you get that name?
Foundation.
honey. It's one of the West Hollywood clubs here in town.
Yeah.
Tell me, what's
it's
your
right.
act? Michael Greer,
Michael
who is
Greer.
Great.
Who
he wrote the whole act for you?
Oh, no, we
what?
Wrote it together.
Together, okay.
We wrote
go
it
ahead.
Together, and he directed. Well, we just, well, Michael and I just finished doing this. Well, we did it several months ago.
What?
The thing called Elegies for Angels, Punks, and Raging Queens.
Really? Where was this
and
at?
This was, we did it at Club 22, but it was at the.
Well, I'd love to see that.
Yeah, you did come to see it. It was about the AIDS quilt.
And we that's all right. I did come to see it.
Dennis
of course,
was
of
in
course.
It.
Uh-oh, Skippy.
I walked out because, I'll tell you, I did walk out.
It was a very
you know why?
Strange.
I walked out
why?
Because it was very depressing. It was for the AIDS thing.
It
I
was.
Remember. They were all sitting around on the stage and they were
yeah.
about the quilt, you know, each
oh,
name.
Right. We all it played was, different. It wasn't all depressing at all.
Wasn't it?
No,
I thought, well, I didn't
stayed.
Stay. I
they
didn't stay.
Stayed because I came
stay.
Out and I sang. I played.
I went with Gigi Gaston and I left
uh-huh.
And I
oh,
just.
Oh, Gigi, yes.
Gigi was
yes,
there and I left and I just. I just. And we have enough of the AIDS thing. I know it's.
But this was different because this was. It wasn't. That's the whole thing was. It wasn't depressing. It was. It was. I understand.
It was a very.
I understand, you know.
I really, Hollywood Lawn, it was very, very depressing. I've
yeah.
lost so many friends, and I'm sure you
oh,
have too.
Oh, darling, I mean,
but
yeah.
I just didn't want to sit through but that particular evening. Now, who is this?
But you'll sit through
who
my
is this,
show.
Darling?
Yes, yes.
Talk about depressing. That's somebody in a casket.
Oh, Jackie Curtis.
Jackie Curtis, yeah.
Your friend, Jackie
told the
Curtis.
I didn't
you
want
even
that.
Put
I didn't
oh,
want that, please. That
why did you? Oh, they put this picture of Jackie in there? Oh, mm-hmm. my Lord.
And that's in the bathtub.
And this is.
Can we see?
In the bathtub.
This is her in the bathtub.
That's
this
is a bathtub her. For the bathtub.
Oh,
the bathtub scene.
Wow.
I love it. Look at that.
Uh-huh.
That's
these
great.
These are great photos.
Yeah. Yeah.
Who published this?
St. Martin's. St.
Martin's. St. Martin's. So they do. They're very good.
They're very good.
Yeah.
And a matter of fact, we just sold the paperback rights to Harper. Harper Collins.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh. Tell me more about your nightclub act. What's
what's
it about?
It's because I used to do cabaret in the 70s when
course.
It was at the height.
Right.
You know Sweeney's
right.
in New York.
One is the best.
Uh-huh.
Did you work that? You worked
no,
it.
But I know of it, sure.
Yeah, of course. Go ahead.
And So it's and I haven't done cabaret performing in a long time because after that club closed, it died. Cabaret died, and then
I saw you in Andy Warhol's thing. They did a whole thing on Andy Warhol.
Superstar, the movie.
Superstar.
Yeah.
Very good. You were excellent in that. Tell me about that. All his friends. Who's some of the people that he really liked and didn't like? Did you know?
It's very hard because I wasn't really close to Andy, but Andy was impressed.
You must have heard.
Oh, well, yeah. It's funny. Just before he died, we spent Thanksgiving together, and it was the first time that I had more than five words to, in a conversation with Andy, and it was really nice. But Andy was very impressed by money.
Cornelia Guest. He loved Cornelia Guest. He loved society girls. Why is that? Why did he? He loved money. Yes, he
because
loved to be surrounded.
He was born,
poor.
Into very poor. I don't know what is Polish, Hungarian, whatever family.
That was a wig he had. That was a total wig he had.
Oh yeah,
it was. Was he bald at all? Or you think? Did you ever see him without the wig?
No.
Did anyone ever?
No one ever.
Never.
Never.
No one has ever seen him without.
But I did. It was true. He was doing a book signing, and some girl pulled his
wig.
Yeah.
Wow, she's like Jose Ibert without the hat. Oh. I think he sleeps with the hat.
Uh-huh.
You know, it's almost the same type of a thing.
It's.
Thing.
An appendage.
So Hollywood Long has had a good time. 15 years old. Come on. Coming from Miami, going to New York City, tough city. Must have.
But I knew the most incredible people in the world, especially during the Studio 54 era. The
Who were some of the great people at 54?
The best designers
were my
friends.
They were great. Did you used to love the 54, Annie?
Sure, everyone did.
Liza.
Oh, it was a great. Tell
Pequeno's
me.
Have known
Liza.
The
yeah. How Halston used to just.
Liza loved you.
Secret. Yeah, I mean, it was. We all used to just. Every night we lived at Studio 54.
How about the Kennedys? Do you see him around? That young boy?
Willie?
Yeah. No, not Willie.
Oh.
The other one.
Oh,
John. Yes, John.
John is not little anymore.
No. Beautiful.
He is beautiful.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Are you always in this attire when you go out?
Well, when I go to the bathroom when I'm shopping at Pavilions. I'm not.
You're not. You're strictly in your other attire?
This is too much. Even if it is Hollywood.
Yeah, so you do your thing the other way. So when you're performing on stage, are you without that and didn't put it on, or
No, I mean, I'm always Hollywood alone, yeah. And
wouldn't it be interesting to do a one...
And your basic cabaret, very comedic.
To do a one-woman or a one-man show as yourself, coming on stage, and do it, and dressing up, as you as running around 15 years old.
Go to Kaja Fall and see that.
No, that's Gypsy. We don't want that.
Exactly.
I don't do that. You don't?
No.
What do you consider yourself more like Hollywood Long?
This is who I am. This is what I am. And first of all, I'm prettier without all that stuff. So who wants to pay?
So you don't consider yourself a drag queen or any of that, do you?
No,
you
I
consider
never liked
yourself
that name,
as a,
I
don't either.
Because the word drag itself is so demeaning.
Uh-huh.
But
you consider yourself as a personality.
But yeah, and an artist and an entertainer, a performer, all anything that has to do with creativity.
Right.
What's some of the songs
you were saying? You're saying some of the songs in the show you're doing now.
It's a very strange show because God, when people ask me, what do you do? I sing. I used to be
right, of course.
And it's very, lots of comedy, but it's different facets. I also, there's lots of drama, of course, I bring in my Puerto Rican heritage into it.
You do?
Oh, yeah. I have this character.
Right.
we're going.
So you do a lot of Latin songs?
Not a lot of Latin, just the little Latin segment.
Kind of Miranda type of things, maybe?
Oh, the mother of us all. But actually, the mother of me was when I was going to movies. When I was 5 years old. My favorite actresses were Libertad Lamarque, Maria Felix, and Lola Flores, who was to me.
Yeah. And I grew up with Carmen Miranda.
Spanish with the castanets and the flamenco.
Yes.
So these were the women before the Lana Turners and all those pagan movies.
Right.
That I, would go home at the age of five and emulate. But then I had an uncle who was older, Virgilio, who we called Loopy.
Loopy.
Who would take me to the movies, and I would sit there all day just...
When did you discover that you were different than any other boys?
4 years old.
Really?
Three, four, yeah.
Is that early, when you discovered?
Early on. Oh, yeah.
So it's actually, people say they, you know, it's...
You're that it can be